In today's lecture, we're going to be talking about something that is fundamental to life as we know it on Earth. It's fundamental to your existence, it's fundamental to your dog's existence, it's fundamental to your goldfish's existence. We are talking today, of course, about photosynthesis. So we're going to get into how is it that this cute little bird depends on photosynthesis as a herbivore, or actually more likely an omnivore, but we're going to talk about how it is that herbivores, omnivores, and carnivores all depend on photosynthesis, regardless of whether they're eating plants or not. So, before we get into that, this is in we have here a plant, we have here algae, we have here cyanobacteria. Don't worry about this text down here. And these are three different things that can actually photosynthesize, three different sort of larger groupings of animals. And these are the ones that the book references, but I also wanted to talk about that extra one is these. These are microscopic Euglena. You may have seen them when you were looking through something in your microscope. These are little protists. That's one of our groupings of animals, one of our taxa, that is actually able to photosynthesize. It is not a plant, it is not an algae, and it is not a cyanobacteria. Anyway, I think Euglena are super cool, so I just wanted to tell you guys about them. And so this might be starting to get a little bit redundant, but where does the animal that is trying to eat these deer, or the casual hiker who's just walking by, anyway, where does the animal that eats these deer get its energy from, sort of like fundamentally? Well, it gets it from the sun, because these deer are herbivorous, they are only eating plants. And when they eat those plants, they are getting the energy from it. And when the mountain lion or whatever it is that's trying to eat them catches and eats these deer, it is getting the energy that they got from the sun, from those plants that photosynthesized that energy into sugars. And so even if you're a person who only eats like meat, which is really bad for you, you shouldn't do that. But if you're a person who only eats meat, you are still getting your energy fundamentally from photosynthesis. As I just said, you are getting your energy from photosynthesis, no matter what, pretty much. I'm trying to think of an example where you aren't getting your energy from photosynthesis. And there may be one or two out there, but if you're eating any kind of plant or animal, that's where your energy came from ultimately. So this is the very, very basic diagram of photosynthesis, and we are going to talk about how it works on a more chemical level shortly. But the basics are sunlight comes in, carbon dioxide comes in, water comes in, and the plant uses energy from the sun to biochemically create sugar from carbon dioxide. And we're going to get into the details of that later. I just wanted to see you guys to see a big overview of how this works. But before we can talk about that, let's talk about the photosynthesis equation. Okay, so 6 CO2, that's carbon dioxide, come into the plant. Where did those carbon dioxide come from? They came from air. The plant, it didn't exactly breathe it in, but the plant absorbed that carbon dioxide, and we're going to talk about how it did that later. But the plant got carbon dioxide from the air. Water is also involved, and where did this water come from? Well, this water was absorbed through the roots of the plant. The plant absorbed water through the roots, absorbed carbon dioxide from the air. You throw in some sunlight energy into this equation, and it makes sugar and it makes oxygen. And so then the question I have for you is, where does the mass of a tree come from? If you're walking around outside and you look up and you see a giant sequoia and it's sort of this massive and awing thing, like how did it get that big? Where did that tree's mass come from? Where did the tree actually come from? Where did the sugar that it used to build bark and build vasculature and build leaves, where did that come from? And actually, I'll give you guys an extra credit point if you shoot me an email. And so, by the way, either the subject of the email or the first line of the email, if you're sending it to me in Canvas, needs to be where do trees come from extra credit. So in order to talk about photosynthesis, we have to talk about the anatomy of a leaf. So you see here, they took a leaf and they're saying that they took a little square out of this leaf and they sort of popped it out and they're letting you look at it super enlarged. Okay, so leaf anatomy is going to be on exam 2 for sure, just so you guys know. But let's just start into it. Here we have the epidermis, which is like the outer layer of a leaf. And the epidermis secretes this thing called the cuticle. The cuticle is this waxy sort of lipidy thing that hangs out on the upper side of a leaf. Now think to yourself, why on earth would a leaf want to have like waxy stuff on it? What is that going to help the leaf to do? Well, that waxy cuticle is going to help the leaf to prevent drying out. Okay, so the epidermis secretes this waxy cuticle to help the leaf, to help the plant from drying out. The next layer in is what's referred to as the palisade mesophyll. I'm probably not worried about the term palisade, but this is where your chloroplasts live primarily. This is where the bulk of photosynthesis is going to be happening, is in the mesophyll cells. We continue down and then we get to what's called the spongy mesophyll cells. This is the vasculature. And when I say vasculature, I mean these are basically tubes that are allowing the plant to move water around, to move sugar around. It's in the same kind of sense that you have veins. Leaves have veins too. It's a little bit more detailed than that. There are these structures called xylem and phloem, which we may talk about later. But for now, you should know that the vasculature, the veins of the plant, are happening in the spongy mesophyll. Getting now to the bottom side of the leaf, so this is the top of the leaf up here. When we get down to the bottom side of the leaf in the lower epidermis, there is no cuticle. No more cuticle here. And what we have are these things called stomata. Okay, these things called stomata. And what stomata do is they allow the plant to bring in that CO2 that is so necessary for photosynthesis, and they allow the plant to get rid of oxygen, which is just a byproduct of photosynthesis. And plants will use oxygen to a degree, but they don't need it. They certainly don't need it in its high concentration as we do. And I should rephrase, they do need it, but they don't need a lot of it. Plants could live in a very, very low oxygen environment. The last thing I'm going to mention in this lecture, is that plants are autotrophs. Auto meaning self, troph meaning feeding or food. And autotroph meaning they make their own food, okay? So we are what is referred to as heterotrophs because we eat other things. Hetero meaning other, right? We eat other things. We are heterotrophs. And actually, those euglena I was showing you are heteroautotrophs. They both eat other things and they make their own food, which is part of the reason why I think they're so cool. So yeah, that was the first part of this lecture. You should know about this anatomy stuff. You should know that photosynthesis is principally taking place in the mesophyll. You should know what the cuticle's purpose is. You should know what the stomata's purpose is. You should have this equation memorized. Okay? You should know this equation for sure. I think that's about it. I will see you guys in the next lecture.